Take, for example, this incredible image of a supercomputer simulation known as the Millennium Run, showing the distribution of dark matter in the local universe. It was created by the Max Planck Society in Germany. Dark matter is essentially what we previously thought of as empty space. It is like an invisible nervous system that runs throughout the universe. The universe is literally like a giant brain. It is constantly thinking, using a type of dark or hidden energy that science is only starting to understand. Through this immense network, unfathomable energy moves, providing the momentum for the expansion and growth of the universe.
Go ahead and start spinning that wheel.
For how long?
Rest of your life.
Seven hours ago at noon, I woke up to the news in bed, courtesy of my fiancée, May, that one of my all-time favorite voice actors, Keiji Fujiwara, had died. Surprisingly, it wasn't from the COVID-19 pandemic currently strangling the life out of humanity, which means that it wasn't a travesty perpetuated by the Chinese Communist Party, but a tragedy. And it's the number that chokes me up. 55. As an industry standard Japanese voice actor in high demand, his career could have easily lasted another 30 years, or he could have retired comfortably. Instead, he was taken by cancer. Why was it the sight of the number which finally made me well up with tears? For me, a number is a symbol packed with meaning. I know that the life expectancy of a Japanese man is 81 years, and so by averages, 55 is a young age to die. It's a number that speaks of all the potential which might have remained for him if he hadn't been so unfortunate in this one way. 81 minus 55, that's 26 years remaining. For me, it's easiest to think of things in terms of how they compare to other things. The first thing I was ever told about myself is that I love to put things in line, to organize things by type. I had a bunch of toy cars and I would line them up biggest to smallest or group them by color over and over again. When I was 8, I had great pride in my sleeve book of Pokemon cards. Initially, I had sorted the Pokemon by their Pokédex numbers because I expected, based on the number of Pokemon which had been covered in the first set, that all 150 should have cards by the end of the third set. This was not the case, and in the time before Gen 2 started, they released the Trainer and Team Rocket sets, which sucked, and also meant repeating a significant number of the popular Pokemon before getting back around to finishing the obscure ones. In order to represent the repeated monsters, I had to change the book to being organized by card number and set. Unsurprisingly, I found myself building a chart of all the different ways that people seem to think based on having a career that revolves around interacting at different depths with literally hundreds of thousands of people. I went from 0 to 100,000 insanely fast in a whiplash transition from fanboy to creator, from a guy that had so few interactions with other people that he could never figure out what it was that made communication so difficult. What the hell is so different about me anyways? When I was a child, my parents thought I might be autistic, so they took me to the doctor to get me tested. The doctor concluded that I was not autistic, but I quote, a genius. From that point forward, my parents had a lot of confidence in me. It must have seemed like my insistent countenance of everything that happens in my day and every piece of knowledge I've obtained was a sign of my intelligence. What I recall of early childhood is mostly that I talked to my mom and played poker with my dad, putting him in a gradually increasing debt to me as he continually took my money to buy cigarettes and promised to pay me back double, which I tracked for probably 6 months before I got my 55 bucks and my dad stopped playing poker with me. 55. There we are again. The wheel comes back around. I wish I could say I was surprised. The blunt I'm rolling in this clip is the seventh one I had had today, and I had my eighth before I got to writing this paragraph. I'm about to go buy more. I need to fumigate.
I'm 前らは暗殺の武器を持ってるってことだ。そして何よりお前らこう思ってるはずだ。この列車でこれだけすごい武器を持ってる俺たち逆らう奴なんていない。俺たちは最強だ。俺たちは安全だってな。楽しいだろうな、楽しいだろうな。その奴らを殺すのは蝶を引きずり出すのはソーセージの中身みてえにぐちゃぐちゃにすりつぶしてやるなよ。
もう一体こんなことしたらどんな奴なんだろうな。さぞかしすげえ奴なんだろうな。すごすぎて自分が殺されることなんて考えたこともねえだろうな。
俺負けてらんねえし。
Growing up, my new type mom played music all the time in the car in the house. The earliest show I remember watching that wasn't for kids was Beavis and Butthead when I was 3 or 4. Even though I was drawn to the show for being a cartoon, I didn't usually get the jokes, but thought it was cool to hear them talk about the music videos, and my mom watched for that. Since my dad worked late and went to bed early most of my childhood, whereas mom and I stayed up late, she usually had control over the TV, so I saw tons of MTV, Fuse, VH1, and other stuff like that growing up. It's no surprise I paid more attention to TRL than most shows because even though I didn't like much of the music they'd play, I was interested to know what were considered the biggest songs of a given time in list form. And since I can memorize all the lyrics to a pop song after hearing it 3 or 4 times, I can still today remember the lyrics to most of the songs that broke the top 10 in the period when TRL was relevant. This means I grew up practicing how to sing, specifically trying to imitate the singers I sounded like as exactly as possible. This meant practicing the real Slim Shady day after day until I had it down, but never actually learning the end of the third verse because TRL would always cut it off early. I would rap it to myself at the lunch table when I had no one to talk to and tried doing it as a show trick, but it didn't seem to impress most, so I left it out of my repertoire. Finding the songs you can sing at the lunch table with the kids who sit next to you is one of the only ways to find humanity in the pit of sociopathy that is high school, so I landed on Captain Planet and Tenacious D songs by the end. I learned all of Albuquerque years before my cousin ripped a burned copy of Running With Scissors onto my computer, allowing me to actually hear it because of a kid who'd sing it to me all the time in middle school. All I'd known Weird Al for was The Saga Begins, so I was shocked when it wasn't an acoustic folk song. My role model as a kid was my cousin, 4 years my senior, an pure instinct thinker whose taste was similar to mine, as shaped by my mom, and who didn't mind talking to me for hours about our shared interests, meaning mostly listening to me go on and on, largely agreeing, having felt pretty much the same way much of the time. Or at least not caring all that often to speak up if he didn't. He and I hung out a lot when I was age 10 to 13, and both of us were hugely into video games and anime. He helped me to make a magazine, and when we'd reconvene in my late teens, we'd try and fail to make films together, but that's a story for another time. He was there with me and my mom at my first concert ever, the big day off from Ozfest, for which my mom assisted me in buying an outfit and cutting, bleaching, spiking, and coloring my hair blue so I could see my favorite band, Linkin Park, who were third on the ticket above other then-emerging major acts Disturbed and Mudvayne, and below already huge Papa Roach and headliner Slipknot. That's who my cousin was there for, and their set terrified me. It was loud enough that I found myself covering my little autistic ears for parts of the show, even though I enjoyed it. Dressing up for a concert wasn't something I ever would have come up with myself. My mom dresses up for every concert that she goes to, so in her mind, it's more or less the thing to do. There certainly are plenty of people at the shows we'd go to who were dressed up, but it wasn't everyone. It would never be me again, even at the 40 or so shows I've been to since. My mom had proposed to me that I dress up, so I had the idea of getting my hair spiked to look the same as how Chester Bennington looked in the Linkin Park music videos, and to dye it blue, because that was my favorite color. She took me to 17th Street Surf Shop, a famous, expensive clothes store at the oceanfront connecting it to the city's main boulevard, where I bought a completely plain slate gray shirt. Later, when I was 14 and struggling to find my identity, I would come to identify specifically with the colors dark slate gray and dark slate blue, and to color all of my texts those ways in forum posts. That same year, I marked myself as bisexual in my MySpace profile and then added my mom as a friend late in the night. The next morning, she took me to Hot Topic to go clothes shopping. In the car, I'm sure she reassured me or something, but I avoided saying anything about it. I bought a pair of skinny pants that I found uncomfortable and almost never wore. I've been overweight since I was 15, and until I became a public persona, I had no interest in my body as a canvas for expression. I was afraid to shave until I was like 19, so I let the worst facial hair possible grow in patches all over my face through high school, and never cut my hair, so it eventually went to my knees. At times, I would stop brushing it until it became a bird's nest, matted to my head that my dad would have to untangle like Maniac McGee or else cut it. Eventually, I got into a habit of actually showering every few days, and I would let my mom brush my hair and braid it for me so that it wouldn't get out of control. I was very self-conscious about wearing a braid, but it seemed fairly inconspicuous compared to looking like a trash heap. I wore nothing but sweatpants until I discovered that pajama pants were even more comfortable, and those have been all I've worn since I was 17, except when I worked at Target. My whole life I've bought shirts exclusively based on the fact that they have pictures of things that I'm a fan of on them, because until I met my fiance, it was easier to define myself in terms of the things I enjoy and relate to than it was to actually describe who I am. I had no idea.
Digibro, that's the life I chose. Ran away from home for the cash fame hoes. Staring out to the east sad, has a comment to ask, who the fuck is Conrad? I don't know, I respond stone cold as the one-tier rolls off my gay dead phones. I'm a grown-ass man, it's a grown-ass pain, thinking how I'll never see my old self again. Digibro, that's the life I chose. Ran away from home for the cash fame hoes. Staring out to the east sad, has a comment to ask, who the fuck is Conrad? I don't know, I respond stone cold as the one tear rolls off my gay dead bones. I'm a grown ass man, it's a grown ass pain, thinking how I'll never see my old self again.
That said, my unique aesthetic finally did come together at the advice of an even more impressionistic thinker who clearly wanted to define himself by things he liked, but was actually aware enough of how dorky it looks to wear anime shirts to find an innovative way of going about it. Ghost Lightning made a blog post about how to hide your power level in plain sight, describing apparel he had customized to symbolically represent anime in ways which are obvious if you know the reference, but seemingly normal or even stylish at a glance. I bought a pair of white Vans in college which I'd intended to hand draw some kind of referential design on, but I never had a good enough idea nor the confidence in my abilities to actually do anything with them. Eventually they just got dirty. Around that time, my aesthetic had become extremely outlandish, as I was deliberately wearing all red and buying red shit and insisting on the idea that I was this passion-driven, fire-branded madman who just didn't give a fuck what he looked like from the outside, even though I was literally self-conscious about everything I was wearing all the time, because I can tell it didn't actually look cool at all. I wanted to start the 11th grade wearing this hideous plaid button-up shirt which I was going to write the words "Break the Heavens" on with tape because I wanted to psych myself up for that year and come in hot looking really confident in my unique sense of self. However, it looked like complete shit and my brother Vic dunked on me instantly, so I removed the tape and just wore the button-up for the one time out of the year. It's a shame because I look amazing in crazily patterned thrift store button-ups, but I just never ever ever want to be uncomfortable. It's why I don't wear watches or rings or makeup or anything other than t-shirts and pajama pants and about 1,000 of the same pair of ankle socks, because I am constantly aware of anything on my body and it's so distracting that I can't stop fucking with it. I also can't have any wet droplets on my body or a speck of phlegm in my throat or a drop of sweat on my balls without doing something about it. Culture caught on to Ghost Lightning's stealth nerd idea. My favorites are the shirts with fictional company logos. Badass crossovers and broadly matching colors are also a plus. When I was growing up, I was constantly made fun of for the fact that my clothes did not match. The concept of clothes matching made absolutely no sense to me until I realized it was just as simple as wearing clothes with elements of the same colors. Eventually, I learned that if I bought lots of clothes with chaotic color combinations, there was a high likelihood that anything I wear will naturally match. Now I've got a huge wardrobe, and I can always find an effective combo, and everyone thinks I look cool as fuck, even though I put exactly as much thought into picking my clothes each morning as I did when I was 9, i.e. 1. My mom dresses up for every show because a concert is a deep sensory experience for her. It's not about seeing the band, but about who she was, how she was presenting herself, and who she was interacting with, how drunk she got, how good the band was, what kind of people were in the crowd, and what was the vibe, and did she manage to meet any band members. Most of the shows I went to with her, I always felt disappointed with myself about how disassociated I would become from the experience. All I can think about is the people recording on their phones, or how being short often makes it hard to see, or how the sound mixing is almost always off in some way, or the assholes in the crowd, or any other result of the fact that I never really went to real shows, real scene shows where the crowd all gets what's going on and knows what to do. I did go to some of those shows eventually, but always realized where I was only when I got there, and had more fun analyzing the event than participating. At least until I finally grew enough balls to get in the mosh pit. My brother and I were major headbangers. We went to metal shows where we knew the band's discography and we whipped our long hair in exacting accordance with the complex Mastodon riffs we had fully memorized, and I thrashed in the same calculated manner to those songs all of the 4 or 5 times I saw the band. Eventually, that felt trite, and at a couple of shows, my long-ass hair got caught in someone's belt, one time dragging me into the pit and on my ass. I finally cut it all off, and I'll never fucking have it past my shoulders again in my life. Not being able to cut it in this pandemic is infuriating. Anyways, after that, I started moshing, most recently at the RadCon 4 meetup. Linkin Park was so appealing to me when I was 10 because my shrimpy high-pitched voice matched Chester's perfectly, and it was an actual challenge to develop the breath control to perform not only his extra-long note holds, but also Mike Shinoda's choruses. I didn't consider the fact that the chorus could be recorded once and played twice in a row when I learned to do it twice in a row in one breath to rap along to points of authority. Developing that skill is what's allowed me to rap so fast to this day.
This point is all filling up inside of me. Just took up a seat, there's rain clouds filling the sky, filling the eyes, making it cry like Pinkie Pie's birthday. Worst day of our life, friends going at that a fool. What? Put your pinkie pie out of the loop. What? Was it inhumane? Cause I heard that pain, then I drove that Philly insane now. People say I'm a little too old for this. Hey man, that show's for kids. Well, I don't care, go ahead and talk your bit and talk your shit, cause I don't hear nothing of it. Put a fuck out of the loud black into me, turn to me, make it real that fantasy. But these points are all plain to see, they're on the verge of fucking insanity.
When I was 14, though, I got really into Meteora because I was finally emotionally turbulent enough to connect heavily with its insanely broad lyrics. Same goes for American Idiot by Green Day, but thankfully I had a lot more to look into. When my family moved into downtown Richmond, we didn't have internet for a month at a time when the internet was the only thing I had resembling social connection. It marked the beginning of a depression which was only going to get way, way worse over the next year, and the ramifications of which were going to define the next 9 years of my life. My aforementioned cousin had ruined the computer that my parents bought me for my 13th birthday just months after I got it by downloading tons of music and trying to download porn over LimeWire. It couldn't connect to the internet without dozens of pop-ups appearing, and I had no idea how to communicate this problem to my parents, and they never looked into it. So when I became completely unable to use the internet on my computer, it just became a place for me to write poetry, lyrics, and ideas for stories. I also, at the very least, had all that music my cousin had downloaded, most of which he'd ripped onto CD so he could take them home and listen to this stuff while getting stoned or dropping acid, unbeknownst to me at the time. As a result, the library was full of music that terrified me. When I saw the video for Schism as a kid, it totally scared the shit out of me to the point that I had to warm up to the song. But once I was depressed, it suddenly clicked with it immensely. More important to me, though, was Demon Days by Gorillaz, which a friend had given me a burned copy of, where, unbeknownst to me, the last song had been chopped off before the reggae gospel part. I listened to both of their first two albums hundreds of times, just trying to parse the incredible amount of detail in their soundscapes, to the point where today the albums are just white noise to me. I can listen to them inside of my own brain anytime I want because I literally have it all memorized. Even more important was Francis the Mute by the Mars Volta. My mom bought this album because she absolutely loved the video for The Widow and got more than she bargained for with its oscillations between hyperdense manic jazz rock freakouts and maddeningly sparse 4-minute passages of chirping. It took me a while to parse my way through the album, but I loved all 12 minutes of Elvia to death, and that kept me coming back. Eventually, we finally had internet on my mom's computer in her office that I used exclusively, that had no speakers because I preferred to have the one set we owned hooked up to my own computer to listen to my music while I was in there, even though I was online most of the time. It would take a minute or more to load every single page, so I spent a lot of that part of my life just thinking incessantly in maddening silence while I waited anxiously to find out how someone had responded to whatever I'd said. In that period, I discovered a forum for the Mars Volta where people were attempting to decode its insanely cryptic lyrics that the band was infamous for, and the theories blew my mind to smithereens. A lot of the thematic analysis went over my head, but some of these people rewrote the story so vividly and in such depth that it completely redefined the album. Now, while I was getting lost in those walls of strange noises, I could try to think about what it all meant. This was my introduction to analysis as a means of understanding the world around me.
So before I get to the clip that I'm about to show you, where I talk about lateral thinking and basically make it seem like it's some kind of fucking super sick superpower that makes you capable of fucking being the ultimate human processor, it's not like that. And I really want to make it clear, and this is something that was difficult to do with the anime characters chart because it was harder to find, like low IQ characters or characters who like don't have good control over their mind, characters who have lateral thinking but can't form it together into structured enough thought to actually be able to live their lives coherently, which I think is, you know, again, I tried to say with the chart, you know, lateral thinking is essentially autism. If you cannot get a handle on it, if you cannot control it, if you can't like process all this shit going on in your mind, then it will just, you know, lead you to seem essentially incomprehensible to most people. So I want to read this paragraph he wrote. He said, "The more lateral a person is, the more likely they are to have a cloud of thoughts, and less likely they are to have a single focused train of thought. A lateral thinker can run into the problem of having so many thoughts going through their head at once that they are unable to process any of them. They're more likely to have their attention divided among multiple things and less likely to be focused on one thing. A lateral thinker can find themselves losing focus because of all the thoughts in their head." This is literally happening to me as I read this fucking paragraph, because I'm thinking about my childhood and like a time that I remember feeling this way. That he describes in this paragraph, when I was like 12 in middle school. Like, I remember distinctly a moment like walking between classes and just feeling like there was so much going on around me or in my mind that I just like couldn't fucking form a thought. Like the only thought I had was like, oh my God, I can't fucking think. There's too much shit going on. Anyway, continuing with this. "They are more likely to find difficulty placing themselves in the current moment and less likely to be caught up in that moment. A lateral thinker might find themselves running through the possibilities so much that they can find it hard to make quick decisions. A lateral thinker is more likely to struggle with how they feel about something because they have so many thoughts about that something. This can cause them to be confused about the type of person they are. They are more likely to be hard to comprehend and less likely to be easy to follow. This is because it can feel like a lateral thinker's ideas spill out of their mouths. They are more likely to communicate in jumbled or indirect manners and less likely to communicate directly and with focus. This doesn't always mean that there isn't any train of thought to follow, just that it can be difficult to keep up for less lateral thinkers. They are more likely to be obsessed with minute details that can seem unimportant to less lateral thinkers. They can also find themselves interested in how very different things connect to one another, because a lateral thinker's mind has so many thoughts about so many things that they tend to have a greater grand narrative and bigger ideas." Now, I do think, and this kind of gets pointed out by somebody below, that this guy is attributing certain things that are particular to more lexical thinkers to the lateral quality. As this guy points out, saying it can feel like a lateral thinker's ideas spill out of their mouths. Well, a more impressionistic thinker is not somebody who is as likely to go on spilling their ideas out of their mouth, because their ideas are not going to come out in words. They're more likely to be somebody who just stonewall stares at you and fucking doesn't say anything. So, you know, this can manifest very differently in different people, but this is definitely on point for me and the way that I feel and the way that I felt growing up and the way that, you know, if you were to read my writing, I leave all the writing I've ever done online just because I want people to be able to see the evolution of me as a writer, and how if you read my early blog posts, like that thing I just did where I like zeroed back to a moment when I was 12, it's like, it's just that. It's just constantly like non sequitur. It's constantly a train of thought. And, like, I wanted it to be that way because I thought that was raw. I thought that was true to myself. But, like, as I learned how to communicate with other people, I learned how to streamline that to, you know, to figure out how to, you know, not only organize my own thoughts, you know, which were already very lexically focused in that I was obsessed with charts and graphs and putting things in a line and organizing things into lists. I've called myself a where-lister many times because, like, I enter a kind of, like, fugue state when I start listing, and I can do it all day. You guys saw what happened when the tier lists came out, and I made, like, 40 tier list videos in a row. Like, that is just, like, perfectly how my mind functions, and that's why I developed this chart, to help me understand people more so than anyone else. But this is definitely lateral, but so is the following.
どこ行くの？なんで行くの？いつかあんた言ったわよね。過去なんてどうでもいいって。あんたの方が過去に縛られてる。
この目を見ろ。事故でなくして片っぽは作り物だ。その時から俺は片方の目で過去を見て もう一方で今を見てた。目に見えてるものだけが現実じゃない、そう思ってた。
そんな話しないで。身の上話なんかしたことないくせに今そんな話しないでよ。
覚めない夢でも見てるつもりだったんだいつの間にか覚めちまってた。
I have no fucking idea what these lyrics mean, but after learning that caveat emptor meant buyer beware, I connected with that lyric so hard that I wrote it on a paper that I stuck on my door. I had done this with song lyrics I thought were cool before, but now there was a meaning. I'd learned about the hedgehog's dilemma and who I was and how I think from Neon Genesis Evangelion, and the conclusion I came to is that I was everything and nothing, God and a dead man just the same. I read the Celestine Prophecy because my dad was big into spiritual shit at the time, but he always favored impressionistic takes. Those fascinated me, but didn't seem to hold up to scrutiny in practice, so I remained vigilant in pursuit of more definitive rules. When my relationships ended, they did so sharply. Growing up, I had moved almost every single year, and even when I lived in one place for a while, I switched back and forth between a gifted school and a regular one, never finding a chance to learn how to fit in anywhere. Usually I had a friend or two, but completely lost contact with them eventually. I got used to life being that way, and so when I had to end my relationships online, I made sure to do so in an over-the-top, analytical fashion, justifying my decision to stonewall them with endless pretentious explanations. My manic side was intensely loving, and my depressive side intensely cold. My dad used to joke that I had a second brain instead of a heart because of how manipulative I was towards my brother and generally uncaring towards people besides myself. I was raised by my mom, for whom society's systems had largely proved a failure, and finding concrete purpose while remaining true to her identity throughout life was consistently difficult. When I was little, I thought I was so smart that I would always be on top. When I failed out of the gifted school, my grades would never quite pick up to greatness again. I already felt defeated by school. Once I got my first D in 8th grade, I felt like I'd already slipped beyond recovery as a human being, and I shit the bed pretty consistently through high school, only continuing by way of the occasional manic burst of energy towards making my future better that only left me even more depressed and depraved when I failed yet again. If I've got two brains, then why can't I process what I'm being taught in school? Why can't I pay attention? In 11th and 12th grade, I have mostly memories of reading manga and writing anime blog posts in class. I failed Algebra 2 with a 17% one year and then passed it easily the next, purely because of how different the teaching environment was. School is nothing but an absolute fucking joke to me. My life didn't start to get good until any thought of it was years in my rearview mirror, and at this point I can so barely remember any of it compared to the minute details of moments from my childhood that I'm certain I've blocked most of it out and written over those memories with other data to the point where almost nothing is left. When I started high school, my family lived in a yuppie college town with nothing to do, and my dad hated his job as much as I hated the preposterously elitist and overwhelmingly white kids that nearly all had iPods from my middle school in 2004. But the high school was actually incredibly nice, and I rode the bus with my friend's older brother, a cool senior who was in a game design club, and outright gave me copies of Star Ocean 2, Breath of Fire 5, and Final Fantasy Mystic Quest, just because I was into RPGs and he was done with them. I wanted him to be my mentor. My reading class was pretty advanced, and in the couple of weeks I was there, I'd already read, loved, and been affected by 1984. We moved to Richmond's inner city, and while our house was a gigantic ancient fixer-upper in an inconspicuous suburb, up until you realize your next-door neighbor is a heroin dealer, the school that I went to was definitionally inner city. Even though the old ex-military teachers monitoring the halls in the morning were very strict that everyone tuck in their shirts to make sure they weren't carrying guns, I mysteriously got away with having my shirt untucked every day. You could say I had a certain minority privilege as one of about 10 white kids in the school, which was mostly black and somewhat Latino, but most of the Mexican kids didn't speak much English, so they mostly kept among themselves. It's not as though I didn't talk to people every day at all my shared tables. I connected with kids over Gorillaz music, and since there was actually a Japanese class at this school, I knew some other anime fans, though no one close to my depth. Being cripplingly socially awkward on top of white and getting the nickname Joe Dirt wasn't to my benefit, though, and I never made any friends who tried to talk to me outside of school. Every night I'd go home and spend my whole social life in those flashes of text between silent load screens on my mom's computer. I went completely insane. There isn't a better way to put it. I cried myself to sleep every night, kept a knife under my pillow, waiting for the day I had the courage to cut my wrists, which was never going to happen because I have the lowest pain tolerance of anyone I've ever met. And I masturbated relentlessly, questioning my sexuality, gender, and the foundations of my identity while I laid in bed listening to Tool and talking to myself. I had insomnia until the day when, as an adult, I decided I was just going to go to bed only when I was tired enough to go to sleep. Sometimes I fall into a cycle for a while of falling asleep and waking up at the same time every day, but it always gets moved eventually. I have never been able to find any kind of meaningful pattern in the way I sleep. I only know that until I was able to set my own schedule and go to bed exclusively when I want to, laying in bed staring at the ceiling, sitting with my thoughts and waiting for sleep to come was the source of all the worst nights of my life, of which there were many. But there was something even more maddening to me than my own madness, which was my lack thereof. Even though I could relate to the idea of having multiple personalities, and could even compartmentalize my thinking enough to converse with myself as if presenting two different characters, it is clear to me that both of these characters are as much myself as one another, and they couldn't feasibly be the product of anything besides information inside my brain. I can't know something that I do not know. And so I had no idea how to express the problem, because as far as I could tell, there wasn't one. My behavior did not suggest schizophrenia, bipolar, or borderline personality disorder, and yet I could relate to how all of those were described to some degree. I studied psychology from my teen years on, and yet I could never find something to prescribe myself with which explained what about me was so different from everyone else. Was it just that my parents had such bohemian ideals that they hadn't prepared me for polite society? If so, why were other people able to be even more outlandish and yet were able to fit in? What was so odd about me? I was extremely well-behaved and obedient until my teens, when, like most kids, I was finally able to process enough of my parents' flaws to stop taking them completely seriously. Growing up, my mom would call violent films kill-kill movies, and my brother and I would leave the room when my parents watched one to go play video games, which was often as my dad would rent VHS from Blockbuster and later buy bootleg DVDs from the back of a guy's van, as is customary in the car business. Once I was on the computer all the time and finally found a new home in the anime communities on the Megatokyo forums and the A-board of 4chan, I started getting deeper into porn, with a fixation on Yuri, especially between lollies. Likely as a result of the dysmorphia I felt from suddenly transforming from a loli shota into bearded fat guy that wasn't actually the shortest kid in class. One of the most memorable nights of my life was when I decided to get really crazed and try to find some dark shit to jack off to. I'd recently been shocked and traumatized by finally diving into anime with darker themes like Technolize, Black Lagoon, and Now and Then Here and There, and felt like I'd become a high-powered void gazer. I have no idea by what means I found myself on some strange dark website reading this insanely in-depth article or creepypasta or something, I don't even know, detailing extensively the inner workings of a child's snuff film operation. I did not end up masturbating, of course, because this shit was insanely haunting, but I was absolutely transfixed to the article because of its in-depth breakdown of the function of dissociative identity disorder, more commonly known as multiple personalities. I don't want to go into too much detail because I don't know how true the story was, but it presented the idea that many of the young girls who'd been tortured and made to torture one another in the production of these films had developed fractured psyches as a way of entrapping the traumas they've experienced within a personality which they can dissociate themselves from. The result is someone circumstantially closed off from events of their own mind, possibly fabricating identities which allow them to cope or continue living, but possibly becoming unable to even retain new memories wholly thanks to their fractured mental structure. From that point forward, I obsessively wrote about characters like the ones in that story, with traumatic histories and fractured psyches, and yet I always felt this kind of distance from it. The most confusing thing to me was always how I could feel so much connection to these characters when I cannot convince myself that any compartmentalization of my personality constitutes a separate entity from myself. Is it just because my trauma isn't bad enough? Not hard enough to face? Do I feel too similar to how I always am when I'm feeling different? Who was I, anyways? Every time I see myself in the mirror, I'm surprised. I never look the way I expect to, especially when I'm making a face. Many times in my teens, I would wonder why no one was asking me why I looked sad, since it felt like I was straining my muscles to frown. But then I'd look at myself in the mirror and realize I didn't look any different from normal. I look happy when I'm happy, and I'm very excitable, but I've never had the sense that anyone could tell when I'm feeling sad or tumultuous. When I try to make the kinds of expressions that I see other people make while I'm in the mirror, I have to really figure out how to move my muscles into place. I've connected with no shortage of characters in media over the years and even felt like some were just like me, until I had to ask myself why I don't make their kinds of decisions. Why my writing doesn't come out sounding the way that theirs does. Somehow, what I connected to the most was the style of Japanese light novelists, people belonging to a culture almost entirely populated by people who think like me. Japanese otaku. Otaku are database animals. They're people whose aesthetic sense goes as far as cataloging the minor distinctions between nearly identical characters with highly limited expressions. There's plenty of cool artsy anime out there, but that stuff is not made for otaku. Otaku anime is made with the expectation that the audience is going to be some kind of lexical and lateral thinker. The otaku is someone who is more committed to some element of anime culture as a meta-context over their emotional investment in individual works. It's the superstructure of anime as a medium which makes it interesting. You don't have to be a lateral thinker to think this is cool and want to follow it, but for lateral enough thinkers, the actual experience of consuming anime can almost become incidental to their desire to catalog the show in terms of the elements of it which are subject to their personal autistic fixation. All of this is fine. it's obvious why this culture is so ugly to the impressionistic artists out there who see animation in terms of its incredible potential for unique expression, and for someone like me whose particular tism is a holistic interest in anime's capabilities as a medium. I am a fan of many aesthetically driven shows. However, those tend to have even more specific appeal and to develop truly cult followings in a way that shows which simply feed into the megastructure of anime can simply eclipse without any effort because the megastructure is so much more populated. See Cities for an example of how this plays out in regular culture. I have always connected heavily with otaku culture, but also heavily with the people who are so offended with it. You've probably noticed I hopscotched the line on this channel of whether I think anime is going great or going poorly at different times, and my metric is usually how much unique shit is getting made at a given time. I want even the cultural megastructure to evolve, and there's no better way they can do it than expanding their influences.
You're go.
I'm good? Okay. So you might be noticing that I am driving and talking at the same time. This is me performing lateral thought processes. I am simultaneously able to process information that is being taken in through my eyes and through my body, through my senses, through feeling the road, and drive safely, hopefully. Everybody's slowing down for some reason, so we're just not going to put our foot on the gas. And also concentrate on this train of thought, trying to communicate an idea that I did not even think through before starting this video, except that, hey, this is a perfect example of parallel thought processes. Now, most people should be able to probably have a conversation and drive at the same time, or at least have a chain of thought going and driving at the same time. Like, human minds are designed to be parallel processors. There's very little chance that you have no laterality in your thinking at all. Have I not been saying the word lateral this whole time, but instead been saying the other word I just said that I now
I
can't
think that's the first
to,
laterality.
At the same time. They're both basically the same thing, is the point I'm trying to make. So,
if they're both words.
Now, the way that the brain works is that, as I said before, it takes in new information, rechecks it against past information, and if you already have information in your brain that it doesn't, like, it already is confident in that information, it doesn't take very long to recheck. So when you drive a road that you've driven a lot of times, you actually are not really taking in the information that's actually there. Your brain is just putting the information where it already knows it belongs. Like, it already has that info. It's just putting it there for you, based on the cues that it's seeing, but just enough so that you can tell what's there but not get overly fixated on any particular details, you know, more so than necessary. Now, like, my ability to read all these road signs, to actually notice the leaves on the trees in the distance while also, you know, maintaining this train of thought, like, again, that is, it's a lot of lateral things happening at once. And, there are probably some people who would need more concentration to keep up with everything going on. I mean, I'm in a long stretch of not having to do anything in the left lane on the highway, so, you know, it's not as though I'm in a situation where I need to be, like, highly aware of my surroundings, because, for the most part, no one's doing anything. They're all just staying still. We're all just kind of boxed in this little box, you know, just hanging out on the road. But, like, so, you know, your ability to think and drive at the same time may be dependent on how many times you've driven that same road before. I know my dad is somebody who, he's a very linear thinker, as I put him on the graph. He cannot listen to something else happen while he is trying to pay attention to something. Like, he can't listen to somebody talk and pay attention to a movie at the same time. But he does think while he's driving all the time, but he remembers none of the drive. He has said that there are times where he gets home and he literally can't remember having taken a drive, because he was so busy, he was so caught up in his own thoughts. We're now slowing down from 75 down to very slow.
Yeah, you're gonna have to get over.
Yeah, you might want to put the camera down.
Oh no,
no, they can see your messy coat.
What was I talking about? What was I saying right
now? You were talking about your dad forgetting taking a drive.
Yeah, my dad will literally say that he, like, forgot that the drive happened because he was too busy thinking. So his ability to actually take that drive is entirely dependent on the fact that he's taken the drive so many times that he already has it cataloged in his brain, and he doesn't need to pay attention to anything more than just whatever unique things are happening, you know, like whatever unique cars are on the road, their position in relationship to him. And again, the brain is designed to do this. So on some level, everybody is, you know, is very lateral compared to not lateral at all. But, you know, the fact that he literally can't even remember that he drove because he was too busy thinking about other shit, you know, shows you how linear he is as compared to me, who's fucking sitting here blocking the sun out of my eyes, fucking dodging, needling through traffic, getting ready for my exit coming up in a second, you know, and able to put all that into words. Like, if it seems like, oh wow, he's doing so much lateral processing. What a fucking god. What a fucking beast. Listen to all that. Well, it's like, you know, if I was a more impressionistic thinker, I'd probably be noticing even more things and not be as capable of describing those things. I mean, my read on these situations is very simple. Like, I'm not telling you, like, okay, there's a, I don't know what that car is in front of me. I assume it's like a Hyundai because that's what the logo looks like. But I had to, like, decide to fixate on that to be able to point that out. Somebody who's impressionistic might have, just from the shape of the cars around them, already been able to identify what those car types were just simply from knowing what that car looks like. Anyway, that's it. We're getting off the interstate now, so no doxing anyone who I might be going to place.
I want to talk about what it looks like to be a low IQ new type by talking about Maddox. Impressionistic thinkers tend to come to conclusions based on the impressions that they get and then to seek lexical information which justifies their impressions. Meanwhile, lexical thinkers tend to seek information and then to extrapolate impressions from that information. Dick Masterson is a somewhat lexical, very lateral thinker who is interested in hearing the impressions of other people so that he can compare them to his own cache of data and try to help them to develop their impressions into something logical, as is the format of most of the calls that he takes on the show. Whether that logic be correct social logic or his own made-up logic. When more lexical thinkers come on, he is more likely to take in their data while ribbing them with sarcasm and off-the-wall suggestions about the things they're saying to add levity to the conversations with them. Maddox is an extremely impressionistic, imaginative thinker, which is what made so much of his early humor work. He would bring in statistics in purely parodical contexts and deliberately juxtapose that information against his wacky claims about the world. Impressionistic ideas always need to be dressed up in a comedic way in order for people to swallow them, as it isn't necessarily worthwhile to discuss unverifiable claims until they have been sorted into a more lexical context. Impressions spread best by being memorable, which is most easily achieved either by striking fear and anger into the audience or by making them laugh. In some sense, Maddox was often right, but never correct, and his problem developed when he couldn't identify the difference. He began to think that he was always naturally correct and just needed to prove it by finding the data which backs it up. However, he is so inept that interpreting data or understanding how to categorically recognize worthwhile data from worthless data that in any kind of semi-serious lexical argument he is completely destroyed. Moreover, Maddox's inability to recognize this discordance is the result of the same thing which prevents him from even being right much of the time, his incredibly low IQ. Maddox is developmentally disabled, easily diagnosable with autism, dyslexia, and narcissistic personality disorder, though I posit that the last thing can be corrected through recognition and attempting to change. Maddox's internet past is often painted as some kind of golden age in spite of the fact that his blog was always extremely controversial, not just for its edginess, as he would have you believe, but because of his head-ass takes that no one agreed with like half the time. In the old days of the internet, you would often have certain posts that blew up completely individually while other stuff you wrote was ignored or shit on.
There's a reason he always extensively policed his comments and always had his metadata and metrics hidden. In order to protect the crafted image of a guy who's always right, he can't have blatant proof of how often he's wrong right there on the page. If all you ever read was Alphabet of Manliness, you could maybe convince yourself that Maddox was extremely dedicated to a self-aware character, what with all of the winks and nods he gives. But anyone who actually read his website back in the day would know he was serious. In fact, in the early days of The Biggest Problem in the Universe, the biggest surprise to many fans was how humanely he presented himself, always name-dropping and talking about exciting things he did in L.A. Though we've learned from Dick, it's more likely that Maddox is pulling from an extremely limited pool of often-repeated stories by a man who spends most of his time sucking shit at Dark Souls and seeing no difference at all between the second game and the other two. The man needs to accept that no one's ever going to think he's funny again until he does nothing but videos like the cricket one or makes arguments like the Springs one from that one glorious brief period where Maddox was fully embracing the way that he naturally thinks and was completely fucking hilarious. And all you impressionists out there, stop trying to justify yourself lexically because literally no one gives a shit. Any intelligent person knows that words are an evil authoritarian cancer that only exists to please the dumbest people on earth. Comedy and art is a way better use of your time.
Okay, so the last couple days got a little bit strange. I mean, every day's been strange here in Corona Town, USA. Although, frankly, there has been so little impact here in Virginia, you almost wouldn't even think that anything was going on. People are still out and about, still going places, still doing things. And I know because I'm one of them. Though I try to keep it to a minimum and be safe, but you know. In any case, I'm doing a lot of Grubhub, you know, because they got the they don't charge you the premium, they don't charge you the delivery cost anymore. So, anyway, I got some Grubhub waiting for me right now. But May's working out, so we're doing this vlog. In the last few days, I developed this neurotyping chart. It kind of came out of nowhere. I am in the middle of trying to finish a massive number of outstanding Patreon rewards in the month of April. That is my goal for the month of April. You may have noticed that until this neurotyping thing came out, the only videos I had been posting were rants on the After Dark channel. I got through like 50 of them in the first couple weeks of the month, and then I was trying to also work on my Brony lecture at the same time to get that released. It's like that was my plan to be like the major video I would put out this month while I was busy getting through all this Patreon stuff. And then at the end, once I was done with all that Patreon stuff, oh, on the side of this, I'm also trying to launch my Kusomega Kickstarter, which is close to being ready. There is only one artist who has not finished their part yet, but that's fine. As soon as that's done, then I'll compile the book and start the Kickstarter. So that will be coming soon. But, you know, aside from that, finishing the rants and the care packs that have been, some of them are months behind. Because a lot of the rants required me to, like, watch movies or, you know, consume some form of content that I have to set aside time to do. And so, you know, those ones tend to get pushed back in favor of the rants that are, don't require me to do anything. And even then, some of the rants that don't require me to do anything just get unnoticed for a while. So, you know, all of them have to be done by the end of the month. I froze all the higher level rant tiers before this month began, as well as the pit care pack. So nobody was even able to purchase a $20 or $30 or $40 Patreon reward from me this month. So, you know, my Patreon took a large drop, not only because of the fact that I had closed off those tiers and told people lower your pledge, but also because of the coronavirus and the fact that a lot of those people have now been waiting months for a reward and have not gotten one yet. So again, getting through all that backlog is the most important thing. But It's not so I can reopen those tiers and run the Patreon as I have before. I have been very strongly reconsidering my approach to my career because of the fact that I have been actually running the math and figuring out what my time is worth. How much I need to make per hour in order to live the lifestyle that I want to live, and to also continue to grow. Continue to have more money year after year in my bank than I had before without compromising on the lifestyle that I want to live. I calculated what I thought I need to make that happen. And then I figured out of all the different things that I am capable of doing, that I enjoy doing, that can make me money, what makes me the most money and per hour, essentially. You know, what aspects of my job are the ones that make the most money, and what aspects are the ones that endear people the most to me as a creator. My Patreon exists in a very strange nexus where you simultaneously are paying for me to just do my job, which is, you know, to just like make shit on the internet of whatever I want, I guess. And you also are getting something tangible so that, you know, even if you aren't necessarily the most satisfied with that particular month's stuff, at least you got like a tangible reward that you paid for. So like, that's kind of the idea of offering those things through the Patreon. However, essentially, for a lot of people, they are just buying rants. Like, they would not be patrons if I did not offer the ability to purchase these things. They can be sold on their own. And attaching them to the Patreon creates a system wherein I have to do a certain number of rants every single month in order to maintain those people as consistent patrons. Now, when you really think about the way my career works, doing things through Patreon has never particularly made sense. Because in the first place, it didn't make sense because I was doing it on a per video basis, and determining what videos were considered Patreon worthy became harder and harder as my fan base came to enjoy videos that were not the ones that had, you know, initially made me famous. And especially having this discordance between the videos that get popular and the videos that actually make people become my patrons, which have always been two different things. And the fact that I cannot find more people who could potentially become patrons unless I cast a wide enough net to bring in people from, who would not normally consume my content. Now, or who don't think that it's going to be to their liking, but will discover that it is to their liking once they get into it. So all this time, I've been bouncing between doing videos that are true to myself, videos that are more aimed at targeting the audience, and all the while kind of having misconstrued ideas about what it actually means to be targeting the audience. What is a mainstream video? Like, and I think I've based a lot of it on the negative comments that I get, where, you know, I consider what things seem to bother people who leave comments and use that as a navigational tool, even though it's never been particularly helpful. And it's because commenters, by and large, tend to be, you know, people who feel as though they have identified the rules and when you are breaking them, as opposed to perhaps people who, you know, would rather express themselves by just saying, fuck you or you're wrong, you know, and not really explain themselves, a type of comment that I hate the most. But, like, it tasks you to figure out why. Why does this person hate me? Why did they say fuck you? You know? And now it's on you to go out there and explore the way that you are perceived beyond the way that it is being described to you by people who are in the interest of correcting your content and bettering it, or even if they are in the interest of doing that, don't have the words to actually do it. You know, people who cannot explain to you what's wrong with your video, they just know something's wrong with it, and you gotta go figure that out. And what's wrong with it is different from a lot of different people's perspectives. So, you know, that's why it's so frustrating when you get a comment that just says you're wrong and you don't know what part of it they disagree with. It's like, figuring that out, you know, I will straight up ask people all the time, like, what part did you think was bad? Like, I respond to comments like that now with those kinds of questions because I sincerely want to know, like, what bothered you about this? Like, I can't fix it if you don't guide me in the right direction, you know? So we have to suss it out together. But, you know, that's the useful way to approach criticism. There's a lot of people who you know, I'll talk about something that Econ said, and I consider Econ to be even more of a living computer than myself, but he is understanding, if nothing else, of the fact that, you know, almost what gives meaning to a lot of art is the fact that it is something that couldn't be expressed in words, and that people don't, you know, people don't love things, by and large, because of its ability to follow the rules. There are some people who do. Some people like YMS who like legitimately love a movie for its ability to be structurally and like, you know, to be coherent while also being, you know, something that has a depth of emotionality. But, you know, if it doesn't maintain that coherency, then it has begun to fail. Whereas there are, you know, more impressionistic thinkers who just don't feel that way necessarily, you know? They might appreciate a movie more for being more completely built because of the fact that not only will it stand up to scrutiny, but more likely it will be an even better impressionistic piece, but not always. And obviously people who like schlock tend to be people who like movies for more impressionistic reasons than technical ones. Even if they don't consider those movies to be quote-unquote good, which is a phrase that really, to me, only has meaning in the context of the person saying it anyways, so you might as well consider those movies good, because they're good for you, because they give you what you want from a movie, whereas a technically perfect movie won't necessarily do that for you. So, you know, this is the kind of stuff that I have always been saying as a critic, but in so many words. Like, this whole video, everything I'm trying to communicate here, this is all everything I'm saying here, you've definitely heard before if you watch my videos. There's not an original fucking sentence in this video. It's just new reconfigurations of the same sentiments I've been spewing from the very fucking beginning, because I realized all this shit when I was like 14. Like, I am obsessed with this concept of the many and the singular, the infinite and the singular, the endlessly branching tree leaves and branches of the trees that all feed into the roots at the bottom, you know, the base. Tetragrammaton's labyrinth, as it was once called, or Yggdrasil's panopticon, as I like to call it. The many branching paths leading into the singular, because the universe is like a giant brain, as we explained at the start of this video. All of it feeds into each other. Everything is inherently connected because it's all made of the same parts that are vibrating and moving constantly. Every 7 years, none of the atoms in your body that were there 7 years ago remain. That is to say that you are literally a completely different person 7 years later than you were 7 years prior, because none of the same atoms are still there. However, the new things that get into your body, the new parts that come in, they are, you know, they are made to, they're given the information that the other parts have and, you know, become a part of the structure. So like your memories, for instance, when you have a memory, it's stored inside of cells in your brain, and those memory cells, you know, they do not perfectly create, like, there's not like a solid state of a memory in your mind. It's not like a photograph where you take a photo and you have the photograph and the photograph is always going to look the same. I mean, granted, even photographs do degrade over time, so this is actually a bad metaphor. I don't actually know if there is a storage medium that does not degrade over time, especially through wear and weather. And your cells in your brain most certainly are not, since cells die off and are replaced all the time. So since those cells, you know, are just passing that information information to new cells all the time, the information degrades as it is transferred because there's a loss of information. If you've ever compressed a file on a computer, you understand this concept. If you use Handbrake on a file so that you make a 10 gig file become a 2 gig file, it's because it's stripping out lots of unnecessary extra information that is mostly undetectable to the human ears and eyes in order to create a more compact version of the same, essentially same image and sound. But if you keep handbreaking that file to make the file smaller and smaller, it keeps removing more elements until it becomes very noticeable to the human eyes and ears what is being missed. That is compression. So your memories are going through this process as they get transferred again and again. There's a loss of information, they become more distorted, and eventually new ideas get implemented into those memories. New stuff gets added because of your other, you know, ideas and impressions that it's all being brought up in concert with, you know, being mentioned in different contexts every time it's brought up. So the memory just distorts and distorts and becomes different. And eventually there's shit you just don't remember that you once could. So, you know, memory, very, very unreliable as a medium. And I would have to assume that people who have like flashbulb eidetic memories, maybe there's some way that their memory cells are fucking preserved, or there's just no loss of data between, like, they have USB 3.0 brains or something and the rest of us are still on fucking 2.0s. I have no idea. You know, there's so much that could be possible that would make sense in the realm of neurology and psychology. And I know a lot of it, you know, does have explanations or partial explanations that I simply don't know. But like, even just thinking about what could be the case, it's like, fuck, man, you know, like the research has to just go on to a point where like we literally know why everything, like why every single personality, why everything that makes you unique, exactly why it happens. Like because there must be a reason. The science demands that everything has a reason. Causality demands the universe is run by cause and effect. It's the only constant we have is the cause and effect. Time is not a constant. Time is relative, but, you know, causality is not. Causality, things happen one after another throughout the whole history of the universe, regardless of what point you observe it from. But we only can perceive what the universe remembers. We only can perceive what is still inside of its brain. What is outside of its brain is dark matter. Anything that is not inside the universe's brain is dark matter. The universe has to process dark matter to understand it and add it to itself, and by this way it expands. So too does the understanding of the human mind. The more you learn about things that are not already in your brain, the more you understand about things that are not in your brain, and your brain get bigger. Hopefully. Your brain grows when you're growing up, you know. I don't know if maybe lateral thinking is something that you have to develop before your brain finishes developing when you're like 25. Maybe that's what they mean when they say, oh, you know, the way that you are when you're 25 is the way that you're gonna be, because like literally your brain tubes have stopped growing. You cannot become more lateral than you currently are. And I think that lateral thinking for most people comes as a result of trauma and is completely out of their control and is terrifying and awful. And I think a lot of my own lateral thinking is a result of that as well. I think that inability to place yourself, like, lateral thinking doesn't have to be so much of a mind cloud. Like, you are pulling random data, or, you know, data that seems random from the outside, essentially. You're pulling data that for you makes sense to happen in sequence, rapidly to the surface as you talk. And what I would consider to be a flow state, as I'm going to explore in a further video, is essentially a state where, because you are being so true to your neurotyping, you know, behaving in a way that your brain essentially can process perfectly. Like for me, speaking is close to that. I can speak very well, and oftentimes if I get into the right zone where I know exactly what I'm saying, then I just go, like I am right now in this sentence that it's happening, unlike the previous sentence where that was not happening. But that is a flow state, but it's not the easiest one for me to enter, which is making lists, making categorizations. I can literally just, like, when I start making a list, I can't stop. I just do it for days. I don't notice time passing. I don't eat. I don't do anything. And it feels like there's a lot of adrenaline running through my brain. And when it's over, I feel exhausted. Like, when I made this neurotyping chart video, the anime one, that was literally like 4 days of, that was all I did, was make this thing, because it didn't, like, that wasn't even a question in my mind. Like, it wasn't like I thought about anything else. Like, I had no room in my brain for anything other than this chart, because I was just, you know, just processing these ideas regardless of making something out of it, just applying it to my own life, you know, thinking about myself in the context of this chart and thinking about other people and having a better understanding of people now that I can help to codify something that I've always been recognizing. You know, it's not as though I didn't know that people thought in these ways. I just never had a way to sort of map it out and see, like, what's the difference? How do these people compare to one another? Where would they fit in a spectrum of people who think this way versus this way, you know? And what would be the, what is that spectrum? Because at first I was considering it the autism spectrum, then it was the autism versus dyslexia spectrum, and now it's a cross-section of both of those, and when I look at it that way, it finally makes sense, and it feels like everybody fits. You know, I can look at any person, any character, consider the way they think, if I have enough of conversations with them, if I think enough, you know, if we can parse it out together exactly where they would place themselves on this grid, then it will make sense. And it might not be the most complete way to understand someone, but it is a good start in being able to communicate with somebody who you maybe initially can't understand why they choose the words that they choose, why they, you know, just why they act how they act. Again, the easiest way to figure out why someone acts the way they act is to figure out how they think. And, you know, there's more to it. There's more to do with their upbringing, again, and their temperament and their IQ. But all those things, you know, that's the nuance that this chart is not necessarily built to explore, which is why I wanted to present how many different nuanced ways these brain typings could manifest, while still understanding that, you know, knowing how someone thinks will still get you a long way towards starting to understand them, you know? So that's kind of the goal of it. And for me personally, it really is like, okay, we've come back around, where the circle has come back around again, and now you have to reanalyze your whole life to fit this new understanding into everything that you've always thought, you know? So I continued working on the project obsessively because I just couldn't pull myself away from thinking about it. Like, it was getting to, it's like it's out of my control to an extent, because the part of me that feels that understanding this will make my life better from here on out, like that internalizing this as much as possible will really help me to make decisions in the future even better, even quicker, communicate more easily with people, like knowing that that's the case, I can't pull myself away from it. I can't convince myself that something else is more important, even if it's like, you know, I'm in the middle of a fucking maelstrom of shit I have to do, you know? Like, I have to do, again, the rants and care packs for the patrons. I want to finish my Kickstarter, which, you know, luckily for me, is not completely dependent on me when it's ready. You know, me and Nate want to relaunch the Cantent channel and do a whole thing to do a whole Kickstarter to move him down here. He's working on Final Fantasy VII Remake shit right now, so I guess we're both too busy to get that done right now. You know, I've got a big video that I was already writing before RadCon 4 started, I've still got RadCon 4 stuff to do. I've got to finish the RadCon 4, Road to RadCon 4 light novel, which has to have a physical edition made. We're still working on like the rap and some other stuff. Mostly not stuff I'm involved with. I still have to make some behind the scenes videos, use this footage I have from the meetup. So yeah, there's just anytime, like I literally forget about this stuff because there's so much of it that I have to return and catalog it and write it all out again to see how much of it there is. And then I realize, oh, like I've been in the mindset that I can get this all done in like a couple of weeks. But when I actually write it all out, there's no amount, that's not an amount of time. that's not a time frame in which this can all get done, you know? So it just keeps piling up. And even when I'm trying to plow through it, you know, I was trying to just plow through the rants, but like because of the fact that I thought about this autism for another minute and then had this idea for this chart, it was like, oh fuck, like I need to work through this. I need to get this off of my chest. And then, you know, my mentality towards it was like, this is such a good idea that like, if this takes off, like if people like this video, if this video gets a lot of views, then I can just run with this. Like if people find this super helpful, if people want to think of the world in terms of this chart, then, you know, I need to strike while the iron is hot and make more videos and make sure people really understand it. So my initial thought was like, I'm going to make a bunch of other videos about, you know, other subjects relating to anime, which I'm still going to do. I mean, I'm still going to do all these video ideas, but like I wanted to do them all immediately, you know, like my first immediate instinct was do other ones related to anime, do other mediums, do like a rapper's chart, do all this other stuff. And I made some charts just like even to help myself process, do the YouTuber's chart, which me and May ended up doing as a live stream, which was a lot of fun. You know, just do all these charts relating to mediums as though you were doing tier list videos, you know. But also, you know, more broad concept ones like, you know, flow state and stuff like that that I want to do. But before I could even do any of that, like just talking to people about the video was super exciting because my Discord literally had 2 days of non-stop discussion about this video. So I was in the Discord talking to people about it, getting excited with them. I created a subreddit for it. And like, you know, the more people talk about it, the more I understand it, the more they understand it, the more we hash it out, the more videos I make about it, the more people get it. So it's like, what parts were missing, right? So I did the lexical versus impressionistic one, the one where we expanded on the chart and perfected it. Like I sat there with the people in the Discord, we fixed all the names, you know, and like the chart is now like how I want it to be, you know. I feel very confident about it, and I like all the names. So I'm Gucci. I can do this chart for the rest of my fucking life until I come up with a better chart, you know, like, which is how I've approached everything forever. Like, if you go back through my anime blog, click on, like, the tab that says favorites, and you'll find, like, every 6 months a new rubric by which I've come to define what, for me, makes a good anime, or, like, what new chart I've developed to understand the world around me, you know. The autism chart was pretty good. People liked the autism chart, especially the autistic people, but this is next level. You know, this accounts for everybody. Everybody can have a place on this chart, as long as you understand it. So, you know, I wasn't going to make one explaining linear versus lateral thought because I thought that, you know, I just figured that anybody who was a lateral thinker would get it right away. And if you didn't, then that's fine. You're just the other one. But, so, I read on, there were some people who were calling me out on the fact that, like, I am clearly, like, impressionist drool, lexicals drool, and I also make lateral thinking sound like a superpower. Well, obviously these things have served me well in my career, and, like, the fact that I live a lifestyle where I, you know, where being true to myself powers my, you know, ability to make money. You know, having a career like that makes it feel like this way of thinking is very powerful, is like, you know, a potent way of living your life, even if it does have its drawbacks, but they all do. You know, obviously, any style of thinking.
I'm going this way.
Any style of thinking has its drawbacks, but you know, if so I read that post, the one that I read earlier on Reddit, about lateral thinking, and all I had read initially was the first two sentences, and I immediately agreed with it. I immediately identified with it. I was like, this guy clearly thinks similarly to myself, and he's totally right. I gotta address this. Do you want to be in this video? Oh, you're going over there? Okay, let me go this way then. So, you know, I read the first two sentences and was just like, yeah, instantly agree. But I had read it, like, right before I was gonna go for a drive to buy weed. So, me and May are in the car, and I'm like, hey, this, you know, driving and having a conversation at the same time, isn't that kind of like lateral thinking, you know? So we recorded that clip, and when we got home, I was like, getting ready to upload it, but I thought, you know, it's really funny that, like, in this video I present lateral thinking, like, it's, you know, I was being over the top on purpose, but, like, I do make it out like, yeah, dude, lateral thinking, man, yeah, it's the shit. And so I decided to record myself reading that guy's Reddit post and to put that in front of the clip in the car. And I had rendered that as a video and was going to publish it. However, in that clip, when I say that I relate to this, like, really hard, and I start thinking back to when I was 12, in a moment where I felt really disassociated. I don't know which is the proper word to use. When I was feeling really disassociated, after reading it and feeling that way, I became very disassociated. And I guess you could say I had already been that way for the last 5 or 6 days, ever since coming up with the chart, and that I sort of oscillate between being that way and not being that way all the time, every day. But I guess I would say that, you know, when I was working on videos that had to do with the chart and was convinced that that was, like, you know, the right thing to do for me and my career at this very moment, then it was, you know, I was in that flow state for days of just thinking about nothing but the list, producing videos about the list, and being like, yeah, everything's cool, having great discussions, and just feeling like on top of my game. But after a few days of that, I realized, okay, well, now it's time to get back to doing the rants and doing the other shit so that I can change my career and do all these things that I'm planning and finally catch up on all these other projects that I have to fucking get to work on. But I was not ready. My brain was not ready to move on. And that day, you know, I had continued to, that day that we were taking that drive, it was like not long after waking up that we were going to, you know, that we were taking that drive. And like, that was the day where I had resolved that, like, okay, time to stop making videos about the chart. I covered all the important stuff, lexical versus impressionistic. We get it. It's time to move on. But I couldn't stop thinking about it, and especially after I read a comment that said, like, I need more of an explanation on linear versus lateral, I was like, okay, well, if somebody, like, really needs it explained, I'll go ahead and do it. So that's what resulted in eventually, and see, here's another thing about lateral and somewhat impressionistic thinking, is that you decide you're gonna do things often long before you do them, and long before you realize that you've decided them. Like, I will often think that I have, like, already set in stone, like, that I've already said something about what I'm going to do, because I had so already thought about it. Like, I either had gotten the impression and immediately thought, like, oh yeah, gotta do a video like that, or, you know, something to that effect, and then just forgot about it. But then, like, hours later, it comes up again, and I go, oh shit, that's right, I was gonna do that thing. And, like, that happens to me just all day long. Oh shit, that's right, I had this idea. Oh fuck, I could be doing this, you know? And then, like, there's times where I just don't remember any of that shit, and I'm just fucking blankly watching YouTube videos wondering What was I supposed to be doing? Was there something I'm supposed to be doing today? Oh yeah, there's a thousand things I'm supposed to be doing. It's almost as though my brain, like, knows it needs time to rest and process, and therefore forces me to not work. You know, like, because otherwise I will just work all the fucking time. Especially if I do it like I did with the fucking chart video. So, or like I used to be back before I, you know, found a reason to stop working so much. In meeting May. But, you know, imminent karoshi. But, shit. So I was kind of out of it for most of that day, but the next day was when things got really, which was yesterday, was when things got really fucked. Because the first thing that happened when I woke up was that I found out that Keiji Fujiwara had died. And I was really upset. But, like, for me, when something bad happens, my first reaction is to numb myself as fast as possible, basically. It's like, oh, somebody died? Well, that really sucks. And then move on, you know, like, there's no, like, because I'm very resistant to, you know, getting emotional, which is essentially useless. You know, it has no, there's no purpose, it will not help you, it will not make things go any faster, it will slow things down. If you can disassociate yourself, then you should, right? But people need to process their emotions. And when they don't, that is when they experience repression. And when you repress yourself, you need to create a further distance from the truth about yourself in order to continue to participate in the lie about yourself that you've built. Ergo, it is not good to repress yourself. It doesn't matter that you have to do your job, you know? Like, our society is built around this factory mentality of the perfectly lexical world where, you know, irrationality is punished, emotion is punished, not being fit for work means that you should be replaceable by a machine. And ultimately, the way that humanity is trending, this is what's going to happen, this is what Andrew Yang was trying to warn us about, is that any job which can be better done by a machine will be replaced by a machine eventually. In that future, in order for us to determine what someone's value is, if there are not enough jobs for people to have jobs, you know, the massive number of jobs that are, you know, created through factory work and things that can be done by robots, how are those people going to live? Like, how will they live in a society where there's not enough necessary jobs for everyone to do a necessary job? Now, I think that the best thing that you could do would be to set them all towards, things that will, just set them all towards whatever will make things better. You know, like, if robots can do this job, surely there is something that we don't have people doing yet because we didn't have enough people to do it. And that's what we need to figure out. We need to be, you know, creating new jobs by figuring out what can be improved or what can be done, you know, to make things just better for everybody. So, like, you know, ultimately that is the hope of a peaceful society, is that because we don't have to hunt and gather in order to eat, because somebody is taking care of that, and we have a social contract with that person that we will not do anything to fuck one another over in the process of them, you know, making food and us powering our brains with that food to think about shit that we should do to make things better, you know. That is the ecosystem of culture, hopefully. So you want a world in which the people who are thinking about ways to make things better are as comfortable as possible and as allowed to explore their thoughts as possible. However, for a lot of people, exploring their thoughts is extremely difficult, and it's not really something they can do on their own, especially because it can be extremely traumatic. You know, there could be a lot of things they don't want to know about themselves or don't want to confront or address, or it could be that the way that they manifest their expression is so outlandish and so difficult for others to see the logic in, that they simply dismiss those people as irrational, even though I don't think anybody is irrational in the sense that you cannot justify their actions in clear terms of how it would, better humankind. Sure, most of us don't act rational on those terms most of the time, but, you know, there is a rationale behind why everyone acts the way they act. It may not be rational in the sense that they are making decisions, you know, for their own sake, but there is rationale behind why they are behaving that way, and being able to recognize that allows us to communicate with those people better and to perhaps help them to understand their thoughts in more rational terms and, you know, not have so much difficulty with themselves. And granted, there are plenty of people who do not want help, who would reject the notion of such a thing, who believe that being the way they are is the correct way to be, and that, you know, trying to force your idea of what is the right way of thinking onto them is bad. And that's fine. You know, like, I don't think that we should ever force anything on anyone. And I think that's another core tenet of America, is the idea that everyone's idea of the right way to be has potential to be the right way to be. And we should not question the fact that, you know, we science is never complete. It's never proven. Ideas that seem crazy can eventually come to be the reality of the situation. So, like, you know, we need there to be a place on Earth where there is a melting pot of impressionistic maniacs, you know, which, like, Trump is the perfect leader of, in a way, because he is an impressionistic maniac. He is definitely the most, like, to me, the most American person I can imagine, you know, in a sense, for better or worse, probably for worse, honestly. But, you know, America is a decidedly off the wall kind of place. And it's really funny because I love the Hunter Thompson quote that I've put in the song Freak Power, where he says, you know, there's not a lot of social or political systems where I could function the way I am now, and maybe that's for the best, or maybe that's the best argument for destroying the system, is that it gets rid of people like me. Now, I think that I would put Hunter Thompson into the Fascinators category on my chart. He is somebody who is very careful with his words. He always talks very slow. He's very considerate about what he's saying. His writing can be, like, even though he writes in a somewhat analytical way, the overall tenor of his posts is not that they're trying to make a point so much as leave an impression on you. So I would consider him to be in that category of writer. And he, you know, his personality fits in line with some of the anime characters that I put in that category as well. So yeah, I would consider him to be a fascinator type. And I think that that is a person who can thrive in America, because if you have a lateral understanding of what you can get away with in America, and you are willing to push those limits, then you can live what is essentially the most thoroughly American experience possible. For me, I understand the American experience from a distance, but do not choose to participate. I am distant from other people. I don't get as much out of actually interacting, with someone directly and getting, well, I shouldn't say that. I get a lot more out of interacting with somebody directly than I do indirectly. But what I mean to say is that, you know, for me, getting that full-scale impression, I will, in my own mind, ultimately reduce it to less than the amount that he might, you know, where the way that Hunter Thompson might describe a situation would probably go into more aesthetic and impressionistic detail about that situation, whereas I would go into more particular analytical detail about the same situation, you know? And that's what makes his writing fascinating and makes mine analytical, you know? But, it doesn't have to be an insult, you know? I would compare my writing most comparably to probably Film Crit Hulk or fucking Super Bunny Hop, like people who are, you know, far more on the lexical side, but obviously have a tongue firmly in cheek and a strong postmodernist streak, you know? That's the kind of a writers that I would compare myself to. But like, you know, the god damn, I get so fucking off track. My point is, look, I say the same shit in every single one of these fucking vlogs about how we are all one mind, the universe is just a collective entity experiencing itself subjectively from multiple vantage points. Our ability to process gray matter is our importance to the universe as we help it to grow by understanding itself and therefore being able to process more gray matter. The more we translate things for the universe, the more angles through which it can understand how to process the gray matter. We are the most dense calculating part of the brain, of the universe's brain, that we know of. You know, whatever living species exists, they are creatures that that exist to survive within the universe as it was built prehistorically from just the gathering of energy in its vortex, you know, something non-complex that that existed to eventually develop systems of life that could, you know, could become complex enough to process information more quickly than, you know, whatever means by which the universe is doing it regularly, you know? So maybe it's just that, you know, the universe relies more on the natural flow of elements through itself, whereas actual processing units like brains can, you know, actively seek information and compile it and, you know, and translate it quicker. So, you know, maybe that's the human experiment on the part of the universe. But yeah, I think that the, you know, there's a great importance in our ability to translate things into lexical codified terms. And I think that, you know, the ability to do that is tremendously important, especially when building the basic founding blocks of a society. But it always has to be done with the acknowledgement that that is not the end-all be-all, that everything is subject to change, that the more we translate, the more gray matter and impressionistic ideas we come to understand, the more we will change our lexical codification of the world around us. When people talk about psychology, for instance, you know, we tend to use the terms that exist and take them seriously as though you shouldn't, you know, you shouldn't describe it in any other way, even though the field is constantly evolving, the terms are constantly evolving, and the most helpful way for the average person to think of it is not to think about the parts that change in their definition, but to think about the things that don't change, to think about the fact that, you know, the shape of your brain is a deterministic feature of yourself, and if it has qualities that can be codified that, you know, regardless of our understanding of why they are that way, it's helpful to know that it's a thing, you know? And culturally, we do that. MBTI doesn't have to be scientific to permeate culture because it has so much truthiness, as Stephen Colbert called it, you know? That is exactly the element I'm describing, as you know, Hunter Thompson was described as the most honest, least truthful journalist, you know, because everything he said, you knew it was the case, regardless of whether he put it into terms that were understandable, because you were capable of believing that he just knew enough. You are capable of believing that he wouldn't say something he didn't believe was true based on having done his due diligence, because he's such a good fucking journalist that he, you know, he paints out the due diligence in the pages of, you know, of a fantastical version of reality. So, you know, Jesus fucking Christ. So basically what I'm trying to say is that if you are an impressionistic thinker, please have some patience for the fact that when people like me tell you I didn't mean to imply something, we really mean it. We really don't mean to imply something that we don't say, unless we are, you know, like deliberately lying. And I think that you should be able to determine through someone's behavior, you know, whether they are inclined to do such a thing. I think that some of us, you know, we might conceal the truth in our words, but I think it is obvious, and I think you should be able to figure out the tells, because it's not always the case, and very often we are mistaken for, you know, for meaning more than what is said in the words, when what we are very particular about the definitions of those words, and that we mean exactly what those words say, you know? And vice versa, if you find yourself confused by why somebody would make the word choice that they do when it doesn't mean literally what they are trying to say, and you can tell that, just accept it. Just accept it and move on. Just think, okay, I know you're wrong, but whatever, you know? If you can find a way to correct them that doesn't make you come off like you're...